Good afternoon. My name is Fenghua Yu. I'm going to talk about resource allocation through the Intel Resource Director Technology, RDT. I work for Intel OTC. I'm a kernel developer, so this is mainly focused on the kernel side. Recently, Intel Resource just introduced the Intel RDT. There are two parts. One is the monitoring part. One is the allocation part. In the monitoring part, we can allocate, we can monitor cache and the memory bandwidth, so CMT and MBM. In the allocation part, we can allocate cache, which is the CET technology, right? Later on, we may allocate more resources. So this is CET, and also we have the CDP, code and data prioritization. So basically, the monitoring just passively monitor the resources usage to identify QoS and the performance issues. And the allocation part is actively allocate resources to achieve better QoS and the performance. In this presentation, we mainly talk about the allocation part. The monitoring part is another topic. So we talk about the resource allocation. So what's the problem? Right now, we just focus on the resource. Just now, we mentioned about it covers several resources, right? But the first implementation is only cache allocation. So we mainly talk about cache allocation. So what's the problem of the cache sharing? This is a long-lasting issue. Since the first cache introduced, actually we have this kind of issue. We have some high priority process and low priority process. If they run together, they share the L3, as you know, right? The last level cache. So the low priority cache does not know there's a high priority process is running and the user L3, it's a shared L3, right? It can kick out some cache line, L3 cache line. When the high priority process is running and access this cache line, there's a cache miss, right? Then go to the memory. That take like 200 or 300 cycles to access this cache line. So that caused the QoS issue. For example, in the real time, I list some cases in this screen, but there are more cases. For example, in the real time, right, this can increase the IRQ latency because in the IRQ handler, it may hit this cache miss and eventually go to the memory and go to like a long path to get this cache line from the memory. So eventually it's a long path. And that caused a very slow, very long IRQ latency. And in the real time, that's not what we want, right? And also in the recently on the containers, we may have lower container throughput. For example, in the some container has high priority, some container has lower priority. It's the same thing, right? So the low priority kick out the cache line and the higher priority fetch that cache line and eventually cause very long latency, eventually cause the throughput, very low throughput. So we list some problems of the current shared cache. So what's the solution? Solution is very simple, right? So don't share. But if you don't share, that's in the past at least 20, 30 years, L3 has been shared. So if we don't want to share it, we need to introduce some new technology. That's what we are going to talk about, the RDT, cache allocation, CET, those things, right? So if we don't share cache, then low priority and high priority, they don't access the same cache line. So low priority process access some allocated cache, and the high priority allocate access another allocated portion of the cache. Then they're not sharing. That's isolation, right? So by doing this, then we can have like speed up the high priority process and the low IRQ latency in real time. And we have the high throughput in containers. So all of these benefits we can get from this Intel RDT technology. This RDT, RDT technology, resource allocation technology, first implementation is cache allocation. And the first cache allocation CAT is L3. So L3 first introduced in on the Haswell server, then on the Broadwell server, and later on the currently on Skylake server. And it's kind of going on right in the future servers. And L2 is going to be released in the future as x86 processors. Probably some people already have those kind of server already, I mean the L2 server. And L3, definitely you may have. We have the Broadwell and Haswell and the Skylake server support L3 already. But the L2, I think some platform, I think it's outside, you can access already. And for the CDP, it's the extension of CAT. So this is just not just access the data cache and iCache together, right? It can separate iCache and dcache, the instruction cache and the data cache. So by doing this, the same class ID, it can access iCache and dcache and portion of L3 is used for dcache, portion of the L3 use as iCache. So that's the extension of CAT, that's the CDP technology. This is hardware, CAT L3 hardware architecture. On the left side, it's traditional, very traditional, normal cache hierarchy. The first level is L1 cache, the second level L2, then last level is L3. It's very typical, right? Then L1 is usually it's not shared. It's only it's a per physical processor. L2 is shared by two threads. I mean, two threads on the same core. It could be shared by two half-threading, right? If they're not half-threading, usually L2 is only used by one core. One physical processor, but half-threading is enabled, then two CPU, two threads can share the same L2. L3 is shared by all cores on the same socket. So that's a very typical cache hierarchy. On the top of the current hierarchy, the RDT adds some new hardware. So it's on the right side, it's Q, it's called L3 QoS mask array. So this is some MSR registers. So it's array, MSR array. So indexed by class ID. So each item, each element in the array is CBM. We call it CBM. Starting from 0 to on Broadwell, it's 0 to 15, up to 16 class IDs. So CBM is called the cache bit mask. So this is specify which portion of L3 can be allocated for which CPU or which PID. So the CBM is in this array, but indexed by class ID. So this class ID is per CPU. The on the right side, that QoS MSR, that's per socket. Each socket has one array. On the right side, on the CPU, one is per CPU. There's a PQR MSR. It's per CPU. It's not per core, it's per CPU. That's another MSR. It has two fields. One is the RMID, which is the resource monitoring ID. That's for the monitoring part. Another field is the class ID, the class service ID, class of service ID. The RMID we don't cover, that's for monitoring. We focus on this class ID. That's one field of this PQR MSR. So if software can specify this class ID, when the software is running on the CPU one, it always uses this cross ID unless you change it, right? So this cross ID pointer to the QoS MSR to let hardware to know which cross ID used in this array, then index to that CBM. Get that CBM, eventually hardware read that CBM to know which portion of the L3 will be used. So that's the workflow of this hardware architecture. A little bit complex situation is when we have both L2. Okay, yeah. To share which one?
So basically the PQR register, mm-hmm. is it for each hardware thread or is it for each core?
Per thread, it's per thread.
For hardware thread.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So we continue this multi-resources allocation. Just now it's only one L3 resource, right? If in the future process, right now there's not such a hardware, but we are going to have this kind of hardware, we can expect in the future there are more resources can be allocated, not just L3, right? So for the L2 and the L3, both of them, then this CPU1, okay, there's a new array, which is L2 QoS mask array. So this is except on the L3, right, on the right, bottom corner is L3, it's the same as L3, right? That's control, that's per core, per socket. Then this L2 QoS mask MSR array, it's per core. So each core is per L2 or per core. It's per core has this one array. That's control the L2. So each CBM control which part of L2 will be allocated for the current CPU, right? So the same thing for the cross ID, still in the PQR, it's per thread, it's a hyper-threading, it's turned on, it's per thread, right? So another CPU zero has another PQR MSR. This cross ID, when the CPU is running, software is running, cross ID, the same cross ID. So for example, in this case, this cross ID is one. So this one point to the L2 QoS mask. And also it pointed to the L3 QoS mask. It's the same, shared the same cross ID. So, but it, when it read the L2, then this L2 CBM1 is different. It could be different L2, right? Then when the same cross ID 1 pointed to L3, it read the CBM1 in the L3 mask. It could be another CBM that controls the L3. So eventually the reality is when we set up this hardware in software, in kernel and in the user space, when we set up this, the CPU1 running context has this cross ID, specific cross ID, unless you change it. For example, in this case one, right, the pointer to the, when CPU is running, whenever software access hardware, the cache, it always read from, it's not, I'm not, okay, it's not accurate, it's not always read the CBM. I believe the hardware will cache this CBM, right? It's not always read from this MSR, but basically the hardware gets this CBM and get CBM1 from L2 QoS MSR, and when we access L2, use this CBM, L2 CBM, to know which portion of L2 is allocated for CPU1. Same thing for L3. So the point is the same cross ID, right? It's not a separate cross ID. Same cross ID used for L2 allocation and also used for L3 allocation. So that just now we talked about the hardware architecture. Then we need to enable this feature in Linux kernel. On the right side is just enumeration and enable from the CPU ID, right? It's a very normal case. And also on the right side, the yellow box is the user interface. We are going to cover that. It's kind of a lot of debate on this user interface, how to enable this. We are going to cover this later on in the next slide. This slide is I mainly cover the blue boxes. So this is like a kernel workflow, how to use this class ID and how to use the allocated schema, the task structure, those kind of things, right? So this class ID and allocated cache, it happened during the context switch. So each task, when do the context switch, it has a chance to change this class ID. Of course, you can change it any time, right? You can use a write MSR tool to change it any time. But when you change it, then it's not well controlled. It's out of control, right? So what we do is in the Linux kernel, we just do this during the context switch. When we switch to one process, it has a chance to change the class ID and change the allocated L2 and L3. So that's the running context, right? When we switch to a process, first it wanted to get which class ID I'm going to use for this process. There are two resources. One is task structure. It itself may have the class ID. That's a schema. So user interface can specify this PID may use one allocated portion of cache. So that part, that allocated portion of cache, eventually translated to class ID. That class ID is saved in the task struct. So if task struct has this information, we read from task. If it does not have this information, that means the CPU has its own default class ID that's stored in the per CPU data structure. So we have two places to store this class ID. One is the task structure. If it has this class ID, then we read it from the per task structure. Otherwise, from the per CPU structure. So after we got this class ID, there's one thing is we don't need to update this class ID every time, because this update this class ID is time consuming. It's usually it's take like some people memory is 1,000 cycles to just write this MSR, because that's a PQR, MSR has this class ID, right? Just write this class ID. Some people say it's 1,000 cycles. What I measure is on Broadwell is like 300 cycles. So we don't want to, every time connect switch, write this class ID, right? So to optimize this, we just cache this in the kernel class ID, the current running class ID in the kernel. We compare whenever we read from the per CPU or per task, we get the new class ID for this process. We compare with the stored current running class ID. If they are same, we don't need to write to MSR, right? We just use the current class ID. Otherwise, we need to take a long path to write MSR that take extra like 200 or 300 cycles. After we set up this class ID in PQR, and this class ID pointed to the CBM in the QoS mask, we start running this process. The process will use this class ID and CBM, and eventually this process know which portion of L3 will be used during the runtime. So this is a workflow in the kernel, in the Linux kernel. So now we talk about the user interface. In the past, if you remember or you take care of this part, last year Intel released some patches, try to enable this feature in the Linux kernel, but it failed. Eventually, it's not upstream. The reason is we use a C group interface because it's obvious, right? It's this kind of control. We have a lot of like a container use C group, right? And also we have a lot of other features we use C group, right, to do these things. So we want to, naturally we want to use C group to do the same thing, to allocate the cache, to allocate the L3 cache. Hello? Hello? Okay. But eventually, maintainer does not like this because they said there's some limitation. For example, we cannot allocate cache for kernel thread, right? That's the C group. If you want to do something in the C group, you cannot control the kernel thread. In the C group kernel code, you can see if PID is equal to PID flag is kernel thread, then it return. You cannot move PID to any C group, right? So that's one limitation. Another limitation is actually is the C group is you cannot control the hierarchy. It always you can create a recursive. You can create many levels of C group. That's not what we want. We only want to create one level of control group. So C group can have many like a subdirectory, another subdirectory, right? Many levels. And also, we don't want to like the last year we use C group and it's control all of the cross ID across the platform. It's not like a per socket. So, kind of these kind of issues. Eventually, we give up. We don't want to go through the C group. We create another file system, which is called a resource control file system. So that's kind of parallel with the C group. It's under slash C's, under FS, resource control, this file system. So in this file system, we have the directory. And under this directory, we have four files under directory. One is the info directory, which contain all of the information, like max class ID, max CBM length, and what's the domain, how to allocate, and what's the cache hierarchy, those kind of things. We put in the read-only info directory. Another file under this file system is tasks. This has a PID. The root has all of the PIDs. So that means all of the CPU, all of the PID will going to use the default schema. So schema, the CPUS is another file. The third file is the CPUS. At the beginning, it has all one. It's a CPU mask. So basically, we wanted to let the user input this CPU mask to use a schema. So last one is schema, schemata. So that's many schemas, right? So because it's not just one L3. It could have L3 and L2. And in the future, it may have multiple resources. And even one L3, it may have multiple sockets. So eventually, we have multiple schemata in one file. So users specify, okay, which portion of L3 is going to be allocated in this schema, right? So which CPUs use this schema? Which tasks use this schema? So when we when the user mount this resource control file system, they see four files, right? Info, that's a directory actually. Then tasks, then CPUs, then schemata. Tasks has all PID, CPUs at the beginning, CPUs has all ones, then schemata has all ones. So basically, it after mount, the meaning for this file system is all CPUs, all tasks use all resources, right? So that's the initial. Then later on, user can change this all of the fields. For example, they can make a subdirectory. If they want to create more partitions for one L3, they want to not just use all of the default, all of the L3, they want to create some portion, that's a partition, right? They create, make DIR, then create another directory. Then the subdirectory, I have some example here, which is example is partition one, part and bar one. So create this directory. Then immediately in this directory, there are three files, tasks, CPUs, and schemata. Initial status, tasks is empty. CPUs is all zero. It's all empty, right? Then the schemata is all one. So that means this schemata is not used by any CPUs or tasks. Then user can control this partition. For example, they can move one PID to this part and bar one. For example, PID 1, 2, 3, 4, right? It after move this, move means I write PID to these tasks. subdirected task. Then this task will use the new schema. And also, you need to change the schema. I have the, if you see the LKML, I send the patch and the document, how to write this schema. There's the format. It's very detailed format, how to write this. But from top level, it's very simple, right? So you want this PID, use this schema. This schema just tell, just allow the user to tell the kernel which portion of L3 on which socket, right? So basically it's which portion of L3 on which socket, that's the schema, right? So this is PID, use this schema. So eventually if user tells this information, the kernel knows this, kernel when switch to this PID, it will use this schema. That means eventually the kernel finds the class ID for this portion of L3 and on which socket, right? So eventually its implementation is class ID point to this schema. So that's the user interface. And also this interface is, I sent out the version 1 last month. I'm going to send out version 2 this month. Actually, I tried to send out version 2 before this conference, but eventually I still have something I haven't done yet. So I didn't send out yet. So I'm going to send out probably next week, so version 2. So just some coding change. There are no user interface big changes, except the Thomas mentioned that CPUs should have the lower priority than the tasks, except that small changes, there are no other user interface change. For, at least from the community, I would think it's better than last year. Last year we have C group interface, every people just, eventually the maintainer, C group maintainer does not like that at all, right? So we gave up. So right now, at least this user interface, so far, there's no big objection from the community. And I talked to other people like Google and actually OpenStack and also the Docker container. They don't object to this kind of user interface. So so far, there's no big objection for this. So I have some like usage case. For example, in the OpenStack, we have the user interface, right? We have the user space and the kernel space and the hardware. So from the high level in the OpenStack, so we need to change the lib word. Lib word is not a part of a kernel, right? So what I talk is just the kernel part. And kernel provide the user interface. But for the OpenStack guy should modify the lib word to use this interface. And this lib word just use that resource control file system to change the which PID, basically which guest, right? To use this, to use which kind of schema. That schema just say which portion for L3. So if they do like this, then OpenStack in the higher level OpenStack user can use this another user interface, right? So that's basically OpenStack system admin to specify which portion of L3 used by which guest. So basically that's higher level information. Eventually that information translates to libword. Libword pass that information to kernel resource control interface. And eventually, kernel set up this class ID, which we, the mapping between class ID and CBM, and which port of this L3 used by which guest. So eventually, the guest, when start guest one, for example, it uses allocated L3, dedicated allocated L3 for guest one. And the same thing for guest two, right? So this workflow is like this for the OpenStack, how to use it. And for containers, it's similar things, right? The Docker and the lib container. So lib container just modify, so some people, I didn't modify this lib container, right? So some Docker container people, they should change the lib container and use the same kernel resource control file system user interface, right? Just change the tasks, change the CPUs and the schemata, and set a different partition, those kind of user interface. Eventually, the Docker user system admin can allocate some cache, L3 cache, for some container. For example, in this case, container one use portion for L3, container two use another portion for L3, right? So, but this is, I talked to some Docker and container people, probably they, because this is new, right? They're not working on this yet. But usually they don't care about which L3 used by which container, right? This kind of thing. But in some scenario, actually, I would think they also agree. For example, if you have some high priority container one, another is low priority container two, right? You don't want a noisy neighbor. Like just now we talk about the problems, right? So I don't want like a container one is running and use some cache line in L3, right? The container two also shares the same cache line and kick out this cache line, and container one is suddenly has a cache miss, right? Eventually, it's a very bad QoS. For example, I can think about in the stock trading system, right? Some containers is doing very high priority trading things, right? Monitor the, for example, monitor current stock price change, then find some situation opportunity, then do the calculation. Immediately, it try to do some like trading, right? It's very high priority. And the container two is low priority, right? It's just do some like input or monitor, like just do some like data update or maintain some, just the routine maintenance, right? It's not a very high priority, it's batch tasks. It does not need to run, share the same L3. So container can be like, container two can have a very small cache, right? L3 cache, but container one probably can have a very larger portion for L3. And also it's isolated. It does not want to, like a noisy neighbor situation happen, right? In this case, right? High priority, like directly use a larger portion of L3, then it's just has a better and a low latency and a better performance. And the same thing for the real time, right? Real time can use the same kernel resource control user interface, right? The system admin can launch real time application P1 and also can launch P2. But before that, it needed to specify which portion of L3 used by P1, which portion of L3 used by P2, right? So by doing this, eventually the P2 and P1, they have different portion for L3, then there's no noisy neighbor and has better performance for the latency for the real time. Right now we are developing some resource control tool, which is written in Python, and this has better, like it's kind of have a good user interface, right? It's running in the user space. It has a GUI interface. And the user is root, usually it's root or system admin. It can drag this, like for example, it's L3 partition. The two, okay, this screen is very small, right? So it can have the, on the this get the screenshot from the Broadwell. There are two L3. So that's on the bottom, L3-0, L3-1. So the user, the system admin can drag this which portion of L3 used by which PID. So it's not like a go, from the user point of view, high level user point of view, there are no like a class ID or CBM, right? So all user system admin want to do is just some percentage of L3 used by which PID, right? So eventually it goes through that resource control user interface. So this is a very high level information. There are no CBM, right? So because the last time we talked about in the LinuxCon Japan last month, some feedback from the communities. Actually, we want like a very generic user interface in the kernel, like for example CBM. It's probably is x86 specific. In the future, ARM may use different CBM. But what we think is we want to use that user interface very simple, just x86 specific. And for the higher level, if users wanted to have, does not know the CBM or want to use the same like kernel interface on ARM or on AMD, ARM or AMD may have different CBM, or right now they don't have this kind of technology yet, but they may have different term or different implementation, right? So the kernel will have that kernel interface will have that difference. But from the user, high-level user, they don't know this difference. They all care about this, how much L3, what's the percentage of L3 used by which PID. So this kind of information. So this resource allocation tool is kind of just a demonstration how to use this CET, right? CET technology from the user point of view. And also, eventually, it can be used by the system admin in the real world. But right now, it's just a demo. I just have this screenshot. Right now, it's not open source yet, but we are going to open source this code. OK. So OK. Yes. Yes.
And you have L3, 0, and 1. So is L3, 0 usable by the CPU of course on another socket?
No.
So basically, it's local per socket.
Yeah, L3 is per socket, right?
Yeah.
So on Broadwell, it's per socket. L3, 0 is usually is because that's a different thing. It's in the past, L3 is always per socket. But architecturally speaking, it's not necessary to be per socket. For example, we can think about one socket may have two L3, right? So one L3 shared by half of the cores on the same socket. Another L3 can share by another half of the sockets on the same socket. That's doable. But in the past, there are not such implementation. But if you see the SDM, this is doable. So that's why we created the cache ID. So this cache ID just say, OK, basically just identify which L3, which L2. So the cache level plus cache ID uniquely identify which cache. So that's, we need this cache ID. So that's why I write some patches. And it's not upstream yet, but the maintainer acknowledged this patch already. And it's part of this cache allocation patch. So first of the four patches actually is cache ID patch. So basically, it's cache level plus cache ID uniquely identify which cache. So we need this. Otherwise, I don't know how do you identify cache? So there are no such, in the past, there are no such way to identify cache. Although people say, OK, L3 is a per socket, actually, architecturally speaking, it's not. There are two parts of topology. One is processor topology. One is cache topology. In the past implementation, actually, L3 is a per socket. It happened to be same. But architecturally speaking, they're not same. It could be different, right? So one socket could have two L3. Or three L3, right? It's doable. So that's why I created the cache ID. The cache level plus cache ID uniquely identify one cache. So by doing that, actually, if you look into details about the user interface, we need to identify which cache you want to allocate, right? Which L3. So that's why this is the cache zero, L3 zero, L3 one. That's from the Broadwell. It happened to be zero and one. The cache ID. That's cache ID.
So you have to identify which cores are sharing the
L3. Yeah. So that part is in the, it's in the upstream already, long time ago, right? It's in the slash devices, slash system, slash CPU, then CPU number, then index number, then cache, then index number. So in over there, it has a topology already. But there is no cache ID. So how do you know which cache you are talking about? We create a cache ID for each cache leaf. So eventually, the level plus cache ID uniquely identify one leaf.
My second practical question is, mm-hmm. Is this the data from the real machine, or is it just for illustration only? I saw you can allocate, for example, the green mm-hmm. one, for example, mm-hmm. and also zero, but you can allocate from 32 megabytes to 51.2 megabytes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's a good question. Actually, I asked another guy, Sai, because I designed this, and Sai is doing the implementation. What I asked him is to talk about max CBM length, right? That's 20 bits on Broadwell. So that means the granularity you can allocate the cache is 1 out of 20. So that's 5% of L3. Right. So what I asked him is draw the 20 lines, actually 18 lines, right? Totally 20 portions in the vertical lines. So just tell the user, okay, all you can do is just granularity is 5%. Whenever you allocate cache, it's 5% minimum, right? 5, 10, right, 15. So, but he didn't draw that. So it's, yeah. So that's the granularity 5% on Broadway. It could be different on Skylake. Skylake, same thing, but it could be different in other platform. Yeah. Okay. Okay, so we talk about the performance improvement. Actually, this CET, if you take care of this, actually you can see it's a lot of improvement, performance improvement, actually. So this is UC Berkeley. They did some experiment on Haswell. So they run some network workloads, and each network workload is running in one guest virtual machine, one virtual machine. And this is the case. This screen shows the case. Okay, when you run on the virtual machine, run many workload on Haswell. Right, so there is slowdown, because that slowdown comes from many places, right? Because it's a virtual machine, so slowdown. And the shared cache, then slowdown. So there are many places cause the performance slowdown compared to the just run native, just one workload, right? So, but they use the CET, okay? That slowdown is dramatically changed. It's dramatically improved. So now you can see, for example, these run the workload, for example, LPM, right? That slowdown is 37% compared to the native. Just run LPM itself compared to run multiple workload. Each one shares the L3, and each one is a noisy neighbor with others, right? So they kind of a lot of conflict in L3. So eventually, the LPM compared to the native running just one LPM, it's 27, right? 37? Yeah, 37.6, yeah. But if they use a CET, each virtual machine running on dedicated L3, right? There's no noisy neighbor. There's no L3 conflict. Just one virtual machine just run on dedicated portion of L3. They see the slowdown dramatically change. For LPM, it's slowdown only 1.9%. It's a dramatic change, right? So that's like a very impressed performance improvement, because there are no neighbors, there are no conflict L3. But this 1.9 still comes from others, like a virtual machine, those kind of things, right? So, yes, and each, yeah. And also they have the network, they share the same network, right? So that's still have a little bit slow down. But compare just L3 change, right? CET, just use CET itself. We slow down comes from 37% to 1.9%. So this is another performance improvement done by Intel. Yeah, this is done by Intel. So run the CPU 2009 and the multiple, because CPU 2009 has multiple workload, right? Just run one workload, compare with run four copies of workload, because we want the noisy neighbor, right? So one workload is running, and another three is noisy neighbors. So eventually, so they have the L3 conflict. If we use the CET and allocate the dedicated L3 cache for each copy of CPU 2009 workload, so you can see that this Y is also slow down, right? Slow down number. You can see on the left side, its slowdown is very high for each workload, right? On the right side, use CET and the dedicated L3. Then you can see the slowdown is dramatically changed. It's smaller. So Intel did this kind of performance measurement. I have a lot of other performance measurement. Yesterday, the Google, they did the CET and use our patch. And also they show like a real time, like many times, actually, the latency, many times difference by just use CET. But I asked them, I didn't copy that slide here. Actually, you can see the dramatic change, the CET, for the real time. OK. The current status is we have the version 1 released last month, and the version 2 I'm going to release. And fix some coding issue. The user interface is very small changes, almost no changes, right, except the task one. Tasks should has higher priority than CPUs, that's it, right? Okay. And this is the references. Okay, this some people help me to do, like Tony, Peter, and Ravi, Vikas, and Sai. They helped me finish this presentation, and also other user interface comments, and also thanks for the community to comment on my first version of the patch. OK, what's the Q&A? OK, yeah, go ahead. Yes, that's a good question. Yeah, that's a good question. Actually, because a lot of implementation details, and that's one question. We have the overlap, right? It could be overlap. So you have one portion of the, here. For example, do I have overlap?
I think that was.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, these two show the overlap, right? For example, on the L3.0. We have the green, yellow, and the blue. They all overlapped, right? They share the same. It's doable. Hardware does not prevent, does not block this. And the software, we can do it, right? But in reality, if you do this, you need some knowledge. Why do you do this kind of overlap, right? The system admin should know this overlap, how this overlap impacts the performance. Because after all, the three PID, they share the same portion of L3, although other parts they don't share, right? But they still share some portion of the L3. So it's still doable. If the system admin, for example, I can think about this, if they care some, like, care some noisy neighbor, but not so much, they still can tolerate some, like, conflict, L3 conflict. They can use this, right? Otherwise, if you don't use overlap, it's very, 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 there's less chances you have the null overlap because the granularity is 5%, right? So at most, you can, if they're not overlap at all, you can allocate up to 20 different portions of L3, right? If you allocate 21, definitely you are going to have overlap at least, right? So overlap is hurt the performance, but in some cases, probably you want that. Otherwise, it's not flexible. This allocation is not flexible. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, one more minute. Okay. So what's the last sentence? Okay, yeah. So if you right now to do it, I have the patches in LKML you can download. Otherwise, you can use my GitHub. I can upload the slides. There's one link. I have the, here. So I have the GitHub that has the latest patch and the tree. You can clone it and build the kernel. It has a document in the kernel source tree. Right, so you can see, okay, I have some examples. And also these slides also has some examples. You can experiment on it. It's very good for more people to use it. Yeah. Okay, you talk about like a bandwidth. Memory bandwidth, and you want the allocation part, right? Yeah. So that's, I shouldn't say that, but it's not in SDM, but it's not my position to talk about that. Okay, yeah. That's all I can say. Yeah. I think it's done. If we have questions, we can ask after this, no problem. Yeah. Otherwise, we are done. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay.